Hi, everybody. I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are Armchair Directors.
Crandall, we're home.
Taking a
look. You got to do that Harrison Ford kind
of. Oh, yeah. Take a look at the Force Awakens Comic-Con reel that they showed in lieu of a trailer. We got this behind-the-scenes look where they hammer home that they're using real sets, animatronics and puppets, not as much CGI, and that they are just embodying the spirit of Star Wars in making The Force Awakens. And it's three magical minutes that's better than a trailer.
Yeah, it just captures the magic. None of this is manufactured. None of it is fake. They have taken something that is very near and dear to people's hearts, and it's just on the screen, man. I mean, the crew are not actors. Like, when you see people working on this movie smiling and being happy, when you see JJ always smiling, everyone is just excited and they're happy that this thing is happening, that it exists. There was so much damage done by the prequels. Like, it just broke the hearts of Star Wars fans to see what it had evolved into or decayed into. And never in my wildest dreams did I think that Disney would be able to buy this property and just reset the clock, hit the reboot button, go back to 1983 and say, you know what, we're going to pick up where we left off.
It is one of those things that seemed like an impossible proposition. And now that it's happening, now when we watch this, like, it's so awesome. I love it. But when you watch this and the Comic-Con panel, I just know that somewhere George Lucas is sitting going, oh, fuck them, I did use some practical sets too. You know, like, he's got to be pissed that basically everything they're saying is like, fuck those other movies. We know what we're doing. We're doing this practical. We're doing this. We brought Lawrence Kasdan back because he's the guy that you want, not this fucking idiot. Like, so I feel kind of bad for George Lucas in the way that they are hyping this up is that, hey, remember those prequels? We're not doing any of that.
Well, it felt like to me in the prequels, whenever they used practical puppets, costumes, it was when it was easy to do. But anytime it would have been difficult, they took the easy way out, like the CGI Jabba cameo, you know, anything. It just, the prequels were done on the cheap because they were done by an independent filmmaker making them out of his own pocket. This is being made by like a billion-dollar corporation who is sparing absolutely no expense. I mean, what do you think Harrison Ford got for being in this? Like, at the Comic-Con, first of all, I can't believe he showed up. He was there. He was very humble, very appreciative. He said all the right things, that he's happy to be back and working with a great cast. I never in my wildest dreams pictured Harrison Ford would be part of a group photo where he's waving around like a foam lightsaber or a toy lightsaber. Like, I thought, okay, well, there were two guys left who would never do something like that, and now Ford is done. Clint's the last one. Clint Eastwood is the last guy who would never be caught dead doing like a PR stunt like that.
Right. Yeah, I think Ford probably got $40 million for this thing. Like, I honestly do. Like, it's a huge amount that's off the charts, and so far it looks like it's going to be worth it. I like that we do see those creatures that feel more in line with the original trilogy. Then, you know, episode one did have practical creatures in some of the scenes, and they didn't feel right.
Well, like, even the puppet Yoda
sucked, yeah.
Garbage.
Didn't feel right. Garbage. There was something wrong with it, but this stuff all feels like Star Wars.
Yeah.
And even when we see some of the shots where the camera is moving, and in our reaction video I said, it feels more kinetic than Star Wars normally does. And there's a couple of shots where, like, people are running and the camera's zooming and then panning to follow them, which JJ used in the Star Trek reboot. But I'm fine with that because it's time to maybe jazz up the aesthetic a bit, as long as we get the spirit right. That's the most important thing, that the characters and the spirit remain intact. And so far from everything I'm seeing, it looks like they're nailing it. Like, they're nailing it so far. So they are either setting us up for a great movie or the biggest fucking disappointment of all time. Like, I've already been there and felt that for Star Wars. I'm hoping, like, that JJ won't lead us astray, and it won't be the second time I feel that way. But part of me is, like, really guarded, like, thinking it could happen. We just got to be careful.
I cannot imagine this movie being worse than The Phantom Menace or any of the prequel movies, honestly. Like, this is going to be the safest, like, movie that Disney has ever made.
Right.
And I'm sure that there are going to be some things that happen in it that are going to shock you or, you know, really draw you in for the drama. But I think Disney is going to really try hard. Kasdan, you know, they brought in Lawrence Kasdan, the guy who wrote the old ones. He refused to help George Lucas write the prequels. Mm-hmm. And it was really funny at the panel. Did you see the panel?
Yeah.
Where they were all there. And Kasdan was saying, all of us are here thanks to George Lucas.
I know. Thinking,
but George isn't here.
Well, and even you could tell when Kasdan said, like, I've been thinking about these characters
Yeah.
for all these years. Kasdan had no interest in the other characters like Anakin Yeah. Skywalker and Padme, which is why he wasn't involved in those movies at all.
It's funny how he leaves that part of the Star Wars history out. He's like, I finished, you know, the old ones, and then, you know, 30 years later, here I am again. Like, Kasdan, there were the prequels that you were asked to help out with. And he's like, what?
Yeah, no,
I don't know.
And I did like that they have revealed that the Starkiller base
Yeah.
is the new...
Domino Gleeson.
Yeah, Domino Gleeson. General Hux hangs out at the Starkiller base where the... What are they called? The new regime of the Empire.
First Order.
The First Order Yeah. hangout, which is cool.
Is that crazy how much Domhnall Gleeson looked like a young Obi-Wan Kenobi at the panel? I mean, Yeah. he's playing this evil general in the movie, but at the panel, he's like, he's got the hair, he's got the beard, he's got like the just the mannerisms. I'm like, wait a second.
Right.
It's not just a coincidence you cast this guy who's like a young Alec Guinness. You know, more so than Ewan McGregor was, mm-hmm. in my opinion. Come on. Like, is there some cloning going on here? I don't know.
It would be cool if there's some tie-in, but I don't know if maybe they just like the guy a lot, or him and Oscar Isaacs were both in Ex Machina, so maybe when Oscar Isaac got cast, he said, hey, I know this great guy that you should get, or vice versa.
And the thing I really like about the footage they released, and the trailers in general, is... they don't need the legacy characters to make this feel like Star Wars. Mm-hmm. You know, like the danger was, oh, it's not going to be Star Wars except for the Han scenes and the Chewie scenes and Luke scenes. But they've actually gotten to the point where it's like, even if it's Finn on the screen or Rey, I still don't think that's her real name. When they were introducing the actors, they were saying, here comes John Boyega, he plays Finn. Here comes... Daisy Ridley, and here comes Oscar Isaac as Poe Dameron. There's a reason why
Right.
they left the name off. I don't think Rey is a real name. But even stuff that they're in, it just feels like Star Wars because they've got that galaxy far, far away atmosphere right. You know, we got a guy who grew up loving it, and he doesn't want to put his own spin on it. So, you know, so much respect for JJ Abrams, who could have come in and said, I'm going to make this, you know, mine. Right. Star Wars has grown up. It's evolved. Now, JJ came in and said, get this as close to the original trilogy as possible.
He knows he's making a movie for fans like him. He's not making his own movie. It's for everyone, and it's got to appeal to the magic of Star Wars.
Yeah, and the pressure is on the guy who directs Okay. Episode 8. Because if he comes in and goes, okay, guys, hang on a second here. That was all fine and dandy, but let me show you how it's done in 2017 or
Yeah. whatever. So definitely a lot of cool stuff that came out of Comic-Con. I thought Star Wars was some of the coolest stuff.
It's in a class by itself. You know, Yeah. For me, it's not a movie. And I thought The Phantom Menace wasn't going to just be a movie. I thought it was going to be something that transcended movie. I thought Right. it was going to be instant legend, and it turned out not to be. It was just a giant, like all the prequels were a giant marketing thing.
It was, but for all the wrong reasons.
Yeah, but this to me, it's a do-over. The Force Awakens is a movie, but to me, it's just, you know, another legend, another fairy tale. Things that we can learn from, you know, something that actually has a moral and warnings to it instead of just, you know, like.
Right.
That was never the original concept of Star Wars, and and what made it awesome and what made everyone fall in love with it. It was about the Force, and the Force is stronger than all of these gadgets and toys.
Yeah.
So that's why they called it The Force Awakens, because the Force was most certainly asleep during the previous three movies. And I think it's about time we gave it a good shake and you know, brought it back into the franchise.
So Disney has said that we're probably going to get a new trailer in the fall. I don't even think they need it. Awareness for this movie is so off the charts that literally don't show us any more of it until December 18th. I'm fine with that.
Yeah, and the previous trailer, I've seen as many times as I saw it, they played it again before Ant-Man.
Yeah.
And it gave me chills again, so just good to see it on the giant screen there and see the ships again. It didn't even require a legacy character to be on the screen. Just seeing an X-Wing fly across the screen. And then you hear Han Solo, and I've already seen it, you know, a dozen or so times. But to see it again in a theater, it just gave me chills.
Yeah.
Like, here we go, man. It's it's going to be good this time. Thank you, JJ and Kasdan and Kennedy and, you know, and the whole team. And, you know, it's I'm very close to giving it two thumbs up before I even see it.
Well, 176 days from now, we'll know whether it earns them or not.
All right. Thanks a lot for watching. And until next time,
enjoy the show.
Okay. Star Wars Force Awakens Comic Con 2015 reel. Counting down. 3, 2, 1, play. So they didn't want to actually show a new trailer, which was a smart call, but yeah, this is just as good.
And at first you're like, okay, are we ever going to see any people? But okay, we got R2. I'm feeling it.
R2's enough for me. Just awesome. Man, like real suits, real sets. That's what they're really selling the movie on. And
it is.
It's awesome, man. It's awesome that they can go back in time and make a movie the way they used to make them and just recapture that old magic.
And it's awesome to see this creature studio where they're working on stuff, right?
Yeah. I like that the puppets have that old Henson look, because Henson puppets were just the right amount of fun and creepy.
Mm-hmm. And then they tell us, you know, we are going to have CGI in this when we see Lupita Nyong'o with all the dots.
You have to.
We're going to have the best of both worlds.
And I liked some of the changes to the special editions, the CGI changes. But the point is, like, there are no green screen sets here.
Mm.
At least, like, not, you know, not that they've...
And, like, huge explosions.
Yeah. Next wing. Like, they built the ships. Okay, there's a lot of green there, but...
Flame-throwing stormtroopers, awesome. And I love Simon Pegg in this. Just, yeah. You see the fan enthusiasm coming through. He just wanted to be in it, even if he was in a suit.
Yeah, got the Chewie mask. Peter Mayhew, who's in rough physical shape, but it's cool that he can still sit in the Millennium Falcon cockpit. Because, you know, he wasn't just a tall dude that stood there. He did cultivate a performance with his eyes and his mouth. Yeah, his eyes really spoke. Yeah, you got Peg there. You got little people.
Yep. And just seeing them building the ships here and hearing the guy saying, you know, building the Millennium Falcon is just putting a smile on even their faces. It's awesome.
Yeah. Man, you can just see the excitement in everybody's face while they're doing this. You know, it's not work. It's like, it's a theme park.
Yeah, and it feels like Star Wars... Now, some of the shots they show the cameras getting feel like J.J. Abrams, a little bit more kinetic than Star Wars has been in the past.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I really enjoyed his first Star Trek movie.
Yeah.
So if he brings more of that, it's totally fine with me.
And him with Larry.
Yeah, Lawrence Kasdan. It's pretty cool, man. Like, we lost Lucas, but we got Kasdan. That was not a bad trade, in my opinion.
When Warwick Davis shows up there, awesome.
Yeah. And you know, JJ always has a big smile on his face. You see some of the legacy cast and you know, what a trip it must be for them.
And I love that this reel ends on like a down, like, duh. It's not like explosions and in your face. It's like quiet, like, don't worry, we got this. Yeah. We know what you want.